your mic for a second.
Okay.
Give us a 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
5, 4, 3, 2.
Hello, everybody. We're live. My buddies, who are a big part of this show we're doing for you tonight, are going to open things up with an incredible song. Matt, Jarrett, here they go.
Hey, y'all, I'm Jarrett James, Matt Schumacher on the fiddle. This is a song we wrote for our show, Pickin' and Grinnin'.
Yeah.
I had to give it a plug.
Come check it out.
It's called Pickin' and Grinnin'. 1, 2. Break out the guitar, break out the fiddle. Somebody go get some beer. It's 8 o'clock, let's pick a little and see where it goes from here. We might stay up all night, might get into trouble, but we ain't got no time to rest. So turn it up, boys, let's make some noise and let's do what we do best. We're just picking and grinning, drinking and smoking and laughing and having a ball. Cussing and joking, wishing and hoping and getting away from it all. So pass me a jar and an old guitar. Get that fiddle in tune. We're just picking and grinning, loving and sinning and howling at the moon. Lord knows we ain't stressing, it's just pure BSing. We're just worried about our next bus. We might raise a little hell, but we're sure living well, and right now we're just living for us. Your place or mine, it don't really matter. We can have us a party anywhere. So break out the booze, you got nothing to lose, and raise your glass up in the air. We're just picking and grinning, drinking and smoking and laughing and having a ball. Cussing and joking, wishing and hoping and getting away from it all. So pass me a jar and an old guitar. Get that fiddle in tune. We're just picking and grinning, loving and sinning and howling. The moon, pick it on. Picking and grinning, drinking and smoking and laughing and having a ball. Cussing and joking, wishing and hoping and getting away from it all. So pass me a jar and an old guitar. Get that fiddle in tune. We're just picking and grinning, loving and sinning and howling. We're just picking and grinning, loving and sinning and howling at the moon.
Shoo!
Hey, thanks for letting us open up for you, Don. Don Gatlin, Don Ellis Gatlin Show, Billy Montana, Savannah Jack behind me. Jarrett James, watch us tomorrow on our Facebook Jay. Live show called Picking and Grinning. Thanks again, Don. Love you, bud. Thank you.
That was wonderful. That song was originally called Grinnin' and Pickin'. And it completely turned it around when they reversed it.
Yes.
Literally. It was a great, great song. These guys are very talented, and they're the behind the scenes for our show. This is, hello everyone, this is the Don Ellis Gatlin Show featuring Savannah Jack. And we're going to do a song for you right now that takes you back to 1992. Hope you, someone out there remembers this song. Hope I remember this song. That would be good. Yes, sir. I know she means the world to you, and you only want what's best for her. I hope you know that I'm not trying to steal away from you. She'll always be your little girl. No, sir, I'm probably not the man you hoped I'd be. But as time goes by, I hope to change your mind. 'Cause I plan to give her everything she'll ever want or need. I'm here to lay my heart on the line. All we need is a blessing from you and one from up above. With all due respect to you, can't you see that we're in love? Was it easy when you started out? It wasn't love enough when times were on. You made it work for you, and all I want is that same chance so that someday we can get to where you are. All we need is a blessing from you and one from above. With all due respect to you, can't you see that we're in love? Have a little faith. I can't live without her, no, sir. The band. Thank you so much out there. Thank you, everybody. Well, this is, once again, Don Ellis Gatlin Show featuring Savannah Jack, the band. And the reason I wanted to do that song is because that song was co-written by a friend, Mr. Steve Dean, and they are special guests here tonight, wrote this song with. Way back in 92, probably wrote it in 91 by the time it came out. And he's here tonight, our special guest, Mr. Billy Montana, everybody. Yes! Woo! Man, same guitar. Man. He wrote the song No Sir on. Same guitar.
That is not true.
That's
But this guitar,
that's the Buck Owens guitar. It's actually after taxes.
It's actually older than No Sir, this guitar is.
Is it really?
Yeah, 63, baby.
Oh my gosh. Is it like worth something? Can we auction it off to pay for the show?
No. It's not worth anything. Man, that was a blast from the past. That
Well, that song was very important to me. And You're like my best friend, and we were already friends. We already had a few songs under our belt. We wrote that one. The very first song that we ever wrote, actually, second song. I've already messed up. The second song we wrote was with Steve Dean, our buddy, and it was a song called Love's a Trip, When You Fall.
That's
our second song we ever wrote in the late 80s. It was the 80s. And it eventually got cut. It was Emerson Drive. They weren't even called Emerson Drive then. They were called 12 Gauge. But the name was not the best name in the world, 12 Gauge. You know, so it became Emerson Drive's very first single. So we were batting 500.
We were batting 500.
And we kept going.
That's the thing with mistakes. We stayed in the batter's box. They threw us out.
We kept going.
Heck?
But I tell you, Billy, you are from?
Upstate New York, originally.
That's right. And you live, but your family's in Pennsylvania mountains?
Yes.
Yes, your dad? Love your dad.
Central Pennsylvania.
And you came to Nashville. When did you come to Nashville?
89 years ago.
Now, but you came also because you had gotten a record deal. How did that, your first record deal was with Warner Brothers.
Good Lord. I actually started, like, we didn't move to Nashville until 1989, but we've been making trips here, like, in 83. When did you do your appearance on Be a Star? And
I won You Could Be a Star in 1986.
86. Okay, so I signed a record deal in 1985 on Warner Brothers Records with a band called Billy Montana and the Long Shots. Self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yes.
Had we been the Sure Shots, maybe we'd have had success.
And Mr. Dave Flint was in the band?
Yes.
Great guitar player and our friend.
Awesome. Awesome. Still a buddy of mine. Going to see him regularly. And has a great family. But we had a record deal on Warner's for 3 years. Put out 3 singles. One of them made top 40. It was actually a Harlan Howard song called Baby I Was Leaving Anyhow.
I remember that that period, though. They, like a lot of artists, when you first come out, you already were writing great songs, okay? But the labels, especially the major labels, were so hard on new artists. Like, they loved your music, right? They loved the stuff you're doing.
They
pretty
did.
Much all originals.
That's how we got a deal.
Right. Then they sign you. It's so typical, even to this day.
Hey, you guys are great. Here's how we're going to change that.
Yes. Here's the songs we want you to record. But I'm a singer-songwriter. I know. We'll find you the songs.
No, in all fairness to them, dude, we weren't what, you know, I mean, we got better over time. So I don't think
the records were good. I want people to go. There's a few places you can still check those out.
YouTube.
Yeah, YouTube is one. Mm-hmm. Those are really good records. Really good records.
Yeah.
Again, there's a huge growth in your music and your voice and everything through time. There definitely is. But that's for all of us.
Yeah.
But that music was really, really good. That got you here. And
Okay. Can I unplug that without popping?
Yep, you're muted.
The other thing that happens with groups that first move down to from wherever state they're from, a couple guys in the band move down with you, and there's always a few that take the journey and then they go home.
Yeah.
Who was the survivor? Was Dave?
It was
one?
Dave. Dave Flint.
The sole survivor.
He is the sole survivor. And I mean, I don't blame him. It's a hard business, as you know. I mean, to kind of carve out your path. And, you know, I thought back in the, and now Dave makes a living actually with a home studio.
Yes.
And he's doing fine. He's doing great. And,
player.
Has used to play on the road with Highway 101, which, was also a Warner Brothers act. And, Pam Tillis, he went out on the road with Pam. And so, yeah, he's had some pretty good gigs. But,
and you all written together too.
Yep.
And had some success there too.
You know, I got another record deal. I had an independent deal that came my way in 94, 95. And Dave was, no pun intended, very instrumental in that. Yep. And co-produced it, the whole project with me.
The highlight of the whole record, though, I think, was the keyboard player in the music video.
That was you, Don.
Oh okay. I forgot. Oh, that was me.
Yeah.
Did I have big hair or what?
Yeah.
Yes.
Big, long. We all did.
I want to ask you a question. The first song, okay, you were writing songs. I know you were already writing. What's the first song that the light switch went on and you went, I think I got something special? And do you remember it, any of it? The first song you went, okay, this is something that's getting me attention.
Like going back how far?
I would say when you came to Nashville, like the one you go, I got something that I could walk in.
I'll tell you what. I had one that I wrote by myself called The Way It Was. And Diana Mayer, whose dad Brent was producing the
Legend.
Judds, made all the Judd records that they did as a duo. Diana loved it and played it for Brent. And like within 2 months of my being in Nashville, maybe three.
Wow.
And so Brent was like,
if people don't know, Brent is like a legend.
He's a legend.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, I must have something here. And I actually thought, wow, the music business is easy. I should have come down here a long time ago. But then they never recorded the song, and no one ever recorded the song. But honestly,
do you remember any of it?
Oh my God.
Just a little bit, taste.
Man, I don't know. No, I probably don't
that's
know
okay.
it.
Okay, that's okay. I remember I told this story a few weeks ago, but it's a true story. You know, we come to town, and we were living in Murfreesboro. My wife and I were, I don't know if you remember that, our first apartment was down Murfreesboro. So I would call Harold Shedd up every day.
Who was producing Alabama.
KT Oslin.
KT Oslin.
And had the Music Mill, which is still there, but it's a different thing now.
Yeah, we did some recording there, actually.
Right. So I call him every day, just green, didn't know you're really not supposed to do that. Bug the guy that
That's
level.
That's hilarious.
So I'm outside, I'm doing something in the front of our driveway there in the apartments, and my wife Lisa yells down, "Hey, Harold Shedd's on the phone." I'm like, "What? Like Harold Shedd? Yeah, Harold Shedd's on the phone. He wants to talk to you." So I run up there, I goes. It goes, "I want to come meet this guy. I want to meet this guy that keeps bugging me, this guy that persistent. I want to go."
Wow.
So I had was my first batch of songs I wrote. Haven't even met you yet. Didn't have any co-writers yet. These are just eight songs I wrote by myself.
Okay.
I go in there, and this is how far I got. And I went in the office. I walked, sit down in the office, and this is how far I got. It was cassette tapes.
Okay.
You know, so he puts the tape in my eight songs.
Yep.
Gets the first one. That's how far. I got to the point when I got to the seventh song, I just wanted to make it through a verse. I just wanted to make it through a verse, Billy. Be like, "Hey, my pretty baby."
So he liked him a lot.
Yeah, well, no. So he got done with that, and I'm just devastated. My first, lesson, just devastated.
Welcome to Nashville,
right.
Baby.
So I look up at him. He goes, "Hey, you're a great singer. You find songs or write something or start getting with some co-writers."
Wow, man.
And that was a big inspiration, Billy, to find
it is.
Folks like yourself to to start co-writing with.
Well, I was going to tell you, No Sir really was one of the first ones that I thought that was a smash.
I did, too.
I did. I mean,
And the story behind that song is I had a little bit of that. I still have the cassette, believe it or not. I was working on that little first verse. All I had. And we were getting with Steve that next day.
Right.
So I came in with you guys. You guys both, thank goodness, you both loved it. You go, "Oh, yeah, that's pretty
cool." Oh, it's
a
great idea, man.
I love that. So we wrote that. And I said, because I was worried that we didn't have that song for my brother and I's first album.
Right.
It was bugging me. I know they're telling me, "Hey, we'll find the songs for you. We got this covered." I'm like, I'm not sure, And I never had that feeling in my career up to that point. So I go to, we get the song, demo quickly, and I present it to the people at Sony, and they, of course, they went, "Oh, that's nice, but we're good." So I'm like, wow, I really think this is better than nice,
Wow.
So to my brother's credit, my brother Daryl's credit, we're playing Fanfare. We're doing the big CMA Fest, it's called now. We're doing the big Fanfare show at the old fairgrounds.
Right. And I remember that.
This is totally my brother's call. We had three songs to do. Everybody, Mary Chapin's doing three songs. Doug Stone's doing three songs. Everybody's doing that. So we said, my brother goes, "Let's do No Sir. Let's do this. Let's do that in the set." I go, "But it's not on the album." He goes, "Yeah, but it's the best song we got."
Wow.
Let's do it. And Tommy Mottola, who's the head of all Sony, is there watching. So we go out there. I said, "Okay, let's do it." And the crowd goes crazy. Now, Goodbye Highway, we did in that set.
That's
I
right.
think I want to be the first one,
right.
which is Elvis Presley kind of with the Jordanaires on.
Yep,
That went over fine. But No Sir, the crowd
crushed.
Went crazy. I walk off the stage. Daryl blew Tommy Mottola off like typical Daryl. He was walked right by him. "Hey, the head of everything. Hey, good to see you. I got friends over here." walk off. And so I'm like, hilarious. Yeah, and like Margie Hunt, who was the head of A&R at the time,
yeah,
Margie, introduced me to Tom Matola. I'm like, oh my God, he's here. You know, he goes, swear to God, is what he said. He goes, please tell me that No Sir song is the next single. That is huge. And I covered for everybody there. I went, we're thinking about it. We're thinking about it. You know, and like,
I mean, it's not on the record.
Yeah, I know.
But we're thinking about it.
I didn't say that. But that was a big moment, you know, and that song was the biggest song of my recording career with my brother. So I appreciate you very much writing that.
Appreciate you letting me be a part of it, man. It was
awesome.
You know,
at that time, I remember you had some amazing other songs. One of my favorite songs, I don't know if you remember this one, I do, is called One Shadow.
Oh, yeah.
There's a great song. Somebody should out there in music land should cut this song. The chorus was, one shadow, two lovers, I couldn't let go. So lost in each other, so out of control. I can't help but wonder, do you think back at all to when the two of us made just one shadow on the wall?
You know, Doug,
that's a great song.
Doug Stone recorded that.
I didn't know that.
Yes. Doug Johnson.
Okay.
Doug recorded Johnson. It on Doug Stone. And he and Doug Johnson told me, he said, man, I had to do the same thing with Pine Box. I had to convince him to record the song. It was for, I think, his second record. He was pretty popular. And
did I play that for Doug first then? Because
I don't know, dude.
I was trying to get that on our record, and he never heard it before when I played it. Before.
Well, then that's what happened.
Ouch! I didn't know that till right this moment.
Yeah, but he. Well,
no, guys, I don't think it's right for you. I'm cutting on somebody else.
So here's what you do, man. You start imagining that it's like, oh, he did it with Pine Box, and Pine Box was huge. It was an amazing song, and it was an amazing record and all that. And so I pictured One Shadow doing the same thing, you know, where Doug Johnson convinced Doug Stone to record it and all that stuff. It never made the record. He didn't sing it. He couldn't sing it.
Oh, well, I'm not going to say nothing. But... That's a bummer when you have a great song and the artist that they're trying to get to do it says, I can't sing it. Like, then why are you in the business?
Stop.
Like, no, that's being mean.
Stop.
But it's kind of weird. It's kind of weird. You know, if you're not a songwriter and you're mainly known for being a singer, but you can't sing other people's songs. It's kind of strange. But that's okay.
Well,
that's
I'm a songwriter. I don't really write songs, but I'm a songwriter. So.
Yeah, I don't write songs, but I'm a songwriter. So, there's other songs around that time too, and then before the first big one, I remember just all these great songs you were pumping out. I remember Faith Hill went on her first television appearance ever.
That's right.
She goes on with one of your songs again. I'm thinking, well, this is going to be her launch, and then
you're right.
She goes another direction.
It's a song I wrote with a girl named Diane Davis, and it's a song called "That's What We're Made Of."
Yes,
and what. What had happened was that Warner Brothers, because Faith was on Warner Brothers, and they had Gary Burr record
great writer
four songs on her as a producer.
I remember that.
As testing as who's going to produce Faith Hill. And then they had Scott Hendricks produce four sides. And my song, Gary, which is an honor because he is an amazing songwriter.
He is a great songwriter.
He recorded That's What We're Made Of.
One of my favorites.
On Faith. And so before any music came out, and of course, Scott got the nod to complete the project or whatever. So, but before any product came out on her, she was on National Network, and she sang "That's What We're Made Of" on the Ralph Emery Show.
Sounded great.
It was great.
Sounded great.
She had her hair was like in ringlets.
We were seeing a lot of her at that time because she worked over at Star Trek with Reba's company at the time, and I did a lot of demos. And was writing with a lot of the writers at Star Trek. So I saw her all the time during that period. And she was so excited. And, you know, of course, a couple good things happened to her after that. And she married Mr. Tim McGraw, who you also
had a cut on
his first album.
You are a freaking encyclopedia.
True. That's why I'm doing a show, Billy.
Is he? Does he know all things music?
Yes.
I thought so.
That's an easy question.
Yes.
That's why I'm doing a show and stuff.
I had a song called, wrote it with a guy named Brad Davis, I remember. Because you remember him?
I sure do remember Brad.
Yes, he had a really good guitar picker.
He was really good.
And he was on the road with Stewart. Marty Stewart. I think he played guitar in Marty Stewart's band. Pretty sure.
I was thinking somebody else for something, but
you're yeah, right. I think that's it. But so that's a song called "Ain't No Angels."
And James Stroud produced that first album.
No.
Right?
No.
That's what Stroud did the second album.
No, it was always. I think it was always.
I think James Stroud did the first works of
really?
Then Gallimore came in.
Okay, I thought it was
a group.
Gallimore
from there.
The whole way.
I could be wrong. Definitely could be wrong.
We're gonna look.
Somebody
that
look
up.
That up. Somebody Google
yeah, look
that.
That up. Who produced Tim McGraw's very first
yes.
album?
But
with
you're
Room,
on that record.
With Room at the Holiday Inn.
So the thing is, though, we're getting into the '90s now, and you're all over it. You're all over it. Like, the songs are great. You get your own record deal going back to that
yeah,
now.
Yeah, mid-94 probably.
Right when you're starting to get cuts with other artists, and it's mm-hmm. just right, it's starting to pop. And then you have this fantastic, I mean, again, go out, everybody there, YouTube, everybody, go out, check this record out. Billy's record he did on Magnetone in 1995. The album after that's great, too, though. This album's fantastic.
It's called No Yesterday.
Do you know any of the songs from that record?
Yeah, I know the title cut.
Can you do a little bit of that one?
I could do a little bit of that, but you're, listen, man.
Guys, you're both right. Co-produced James Stroud, Byron Gallimore.
Oh, wow. Co-produced.
Boom. There you go. You're both right.
Thank you. This is a song that, folks, this was a top 40. Rain Through the Window, which album's that on?
It's on this one.
That's a great song,
Rain Through
too.
The Roof. Hey, that video's on YouTube. You can watch that entire Rain Through the Roof video on YouTube.
I think the other one's on there too, isn't it? The other song.
I don't know. I was going to do No Yesterday.
Do whatever you want to do. You're our guest. Whatever you want to do.
Didn't Have You is the one you were thinking
yes,
was the first.
Didn't
I
Have You.
Do that.
That's the one I play piano in the video.
I hope you know
yes.
how much I need you. I try to tell you sometimes, but the right words don't come. As you lie there sleeping, I'm lying here thinking how empty these years would have been, all the living I wouldn't have done, the time I would have wasted. Tastes I wouldn't have tasted. Chances I wouldn't have taken if I didn't have you. Didn't have you. Yeah.
Woo.
Yeah. Thank you.
And
thank
you. You had really flowing, beautiful hair in that video.
Yeah. Yeah, I used to have hair.
Can you get
but I had three kids.
That's true.
This is what happens.
That does. That's very much it's true. And a lot of people don't know this, but you are Bruce Willis's stunt double. A lot of people
exactly.
know that.
Exactly. Yeah, the people don't know that. I don't tell people that. So that's yes. thank you for sharing.
I want to have some exclusives on the show.
You got them.
And that's
you
one.
You already had them, man.
That's
you
true.
Know stuff about my career I don't know.
I'm telling you. I was on an airplane years ago flying somewhere with Delbert McClinton. We were sitting together in first class. Thank you very much. And and I go, I knew more. He goes, he said the same thing. He goes, Don, you know more about my career than I do. You know, I was bringing yeah. up things he hadn't thought about in
yeah.
20 years.
Yeah.
And goes, so I eventually thought when it was all said and done, he hated me. And then he invites me to his thing. Remember Third, not Third and Lindsley, but Third. It's no longer there. Ace of Clubs.
I do remember.
Remember Ace of Clubs?
Second Avenue.
Delbert's doing a show there, okay? And he invites me, so I'm thinking, maybe he doesn't hate me. Then he sees me, and he calls me backstage. You know, like, come on backstage and hang out. And
he punched you in the face.
He did. you took my story away.
I did.
No kidding. And no. He gets me back there, and Benmont from the Heartbreakers was playing keyboards for him that night.
Oh,
so I got to meet Benmont from the Heartbreakers.
Unbelievable.
And he goes, I voted for you and your brother for Duo of the Year. I just want to let you know. So I'm like, oh, my God. I talked his ear off, and I talked, you know.
He
didn't get any sleep the entire flight, but he still likes me, and he voted for me. What a great thing. It's incredible. But getting back to the album, there's a song you mentioned it, Bring on the Rain Through the Window, Rain Through the Roof. Went through the window, rain through the roof.
Yeah, rain through the roof.
That's a great song. Can we do a little bit of that one too? That's again out there in artist land. Listen to the song. Even though Billy had a hit single with it, you need to remake this one and put this one out, in my opinion.
Just 18, fresh out of school, got her diplomas, they said I do. Daddy said, boy, I don't give you 6 months. The way I see it, you've been blinded by lust. We settled down in a two-room shack on a dusty road by the railroad tracks. Train raced at the rafters when they rolled by. It was hot in cold December, hot in July. And there was wind through the window and rain through the roof. Empty pockets, holes in our shoes. We just counted on love and it got us through. And there was wind through the window and rain through the roof. We got through a verse and a chorus.
It's like the Savannah Jack speed round. We do that a lot on the road. We call it the Savannah Jack speed round. The people in the audience will yell out their favorite artists. We play a little bit of a song.
Yeah, I've seen some of that. Man, y'all are amazing.
It's a lot of fun. And so I'm moving up. I'm moving through time here.
Okay.
Moving through time here.
So there was mid-90s. A song.
Yes, I'm in the mid-90s. I'm moving past that a little bit. We're getting closer and closer to that first number one. But there was a few more great songs that came, again, just unbelievable songs. There was one you wrote. You wrote a couple for Leanne Womack.
I did.
You have a song on her first album and second album.
That's correct. Good Lord.
Yes. Now, this song.
I'm just not going to say anything. I'll just wait and you ask the question.
I am.
Because you know everything.
Wait a minute.
I'm going to start asking him questions.
So.
What year did that come out?
I studied my notes.
Who brought coffee on the Tuesday?
I read my notes. That was actually Brian Mayer.
Probably was. Dang it.
But so the first song, the two songs are both absolutely two of the greatest country songs. I mean, folks, again, check it out. Leanne Womack. She's one of my favorite country singers, period.
Me too.
Anyway.
Me too.
So,
and remember, that first song, like, no one knew who she was.
Right.
And it was the same thing with Faith, like when she went on.
Exactly.
And she sang, and nobody knew Tim McGraw when he recorded Ain't No Angels. It's amazing.
But she's a real country singer. Like, she is the real deal.
Great. Awesome.
And
amazing.
The song Preacher Won't Have to Lie is a huge song. You wrote with the Deaner.
Steve Dean. Two-way.
And this song is a special. There's a special moment that happened with this song.
Yeah, oh yeah, man.
And I mean, it's pretty about as huge as it gets. I mean, it's beyond just, hey, my song got played on a TV show or somebody's got, you know, did it on the Grand Ole Opry, which is huge. But can you tell the story of how when you had this cut with her?
Actually, I think you're the one who told me this.
I saw it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you want to say what happened?
No, you tell them.
Well, I mean, the song was not a single. Off that second record. I remember Frank Liddell, who is married to Leanne, but also produced that record. Yeah. He told me about driving across. He said they were somewhere in New Mexico or something, and he was just playing songs while they were traveling, you know, and he popped a CD in, and she heard Preacher Won't Have to Lie, and he said she did backflips, you know. And so... it was after 9/11,
yep.
And the whole country community, they put on a concert, right, to kind of raise money. Everybody was looking for ways that they could help the survivors, and, you know, I mean, it was just a really crazy time in our country, but amazing time of a country coming together. And so they all the recording artists, I guess, Alan Jackson, and I mean, how many people were on that show?
It
must have been
huge.
Everybody.
Everybody's on that. That's why I wasn't.
And so Leanne picked two songs to do, and one of them was I Hope You Dance. Is that correct?
Pretty good song.
And the other one was Preacher Won't Have to Lie.
Yes.
How amazing. What a great testament to
that
song.
If I remember correctly, even President Bush, I remember that, like, Is that Bring on the Rain when he had the when he made the speech and like your song is? Am I jumping ahead?
I think that was Bring on
I'm
the
jumping
rain.
Ahead. Jumping ahead. But get back to that in a second. But then so the songs, you actually had a song called Montgomery to Memphis. Again, an absolutely beautiful country song. And folks out there, all you great inspiring songwriters that hope to be like Billy Montana one day, folks, Billy wrote this incredible song, and literally, he went off to vacation when this song was released. It was going to be her single.
That's right.
And her single before was a big hit. So he's off. They said, Billy.
I still have a CD Pro. CDX. They call it a CD Pro, where they put the song on three times in a row so that the radio programmers and music directors wouldn't. They didn't have to hit rewind to hear it again or push any buttons. It just played again and again and again. So I have Montgomery to Memphis on a CD Pro. And it was a single.
It was a single. And you could literally go off to vacation knowing, hey, I got Leanne Womack's next single. The song before was a hit. This is going to be my first big hit. Mm-hmm. And it's a great song, deserving to be a hit. But I'm just telling you out there how, like, don't get discouraged is the point of this point. Because Billy had many more great songs to come. And this song didn't see the light it should have saw because in the weird game of this town, the politics, somebody came along with a song with the same type premise.
Well, the thing was it was a business decision because they couldn't get our single up and down before Christmas and put out another single. So they decided instead of going a fourth single off the first album, they would go first single off the second album.
But it was a little past Little Rock, another traveling type, type
Maybe
thing.
They didn't want her to be the geography queen.
Yeah, that was very strange. And but again, it had to be discouraging. You come back from vacation, but again, you just went, okay, hey, that's where that was supposed to be.
It was tough.
It was tough, though. I remember it was a tough time.
But yeah.
And then
it's supposed to happen.
But you championed on with great, great more songs. You wrote a song for a guy named Steve Holy, which our friend
Dave Flint. That's a two-way with Dave.
It's called The Hunger, which was on Curb Records, which was just the almost like the opening act for the next thing on Curb. Mm-hmm. When you wrote a song, and I remember you playing it for me, and I remember what I even said when you played it for me for the first time over at Brent's office, over at Dinah's office.
Right.
The song was called, everybody, Bring on the Rain.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And one of the biggest hit songs of all time, Tim McGraw guesting on this one with Jody Messina. And I remember listening to the album. And I'm always honest to a fault. I said, you know what, Billy, this is the best song, in my opinion, on the album. I'm not just saying that because you're my friend. I really do believe it's by far the best song on the album. And I said, Billy, it's going to be your first number one. I don't know if you remember me telling you this.
Yeah, I do.
I go, Billy, this is going to be your first number one because they didn't do anything to screw it up.
This is amazing.
I said, I swear to God, I remember those words. I said, the vocal performance is perfect. The production is perfect.
It
the
is.
Song is perfect. They did it the right key. They didn't screw anything up. It's all there. Having said that, they waited for that to be like the third single. And I know that had to be driving you crazy because might have been the fourth single, okay? Nothing against the singles before this one. But they were all, like we talked about before. They didn't move
product.
They were radio hits. No, not against the other hits. Not against the writers who wrote them. Anything.
Yeah.
But they weren't moving the product. And I said, well, there's a way to ruin it. They move on to the next album because this one ain't selling.
I was believing.
I went, son of a gun. I didn't think of that.
I was concerned about that because it had happened before with the Leanne Womack single.
Right. So yeah. I'm like, here we go again. But they put it out in that great video with the rain.
You know when they put it out?
The award show.
No, September 10th, 2001.
Oh, my gosh.
It was a Monday.
Oh, my gosh. Did not know that.
Yeah. The towers went down on Tuesday. And
that's when President Bush.
Yeah. Well, they took the song, and I think it was like a DJ or somebody, because I didn't know anything about it, and they took sound bites from Ground Zero and President Bush speaking and news feeds and interwove all of those sound bites while the song was playing. And I heard that on Thursday here in Nashville on WSIX, the first time I heard it. And I was driving I think it was a Monte Carlo. No, it was an old Chevy Celebrity, I remember
it
pulling
was a Hugo
up.
With turbo, Billy, be
pulling
honest.
Pulling up. It was a Gremlin.
I remember you had to make decisions like, do I make it up the hill or listen to the radio?
Yeah, one or the other. Can't do both. It's only three squirrels. But, man, I lost it. Because I just pulled up in my driveway and I heard on the radio. Oh, and it was like, you know what? I was excited about it being a single, but obviously when the towers went down, everything changed and it didn't matter. Like, whatever happened with that song didn't matter at that point. Everything became a reassessment of life and the things that were really, truly important. And so at that point, it's kind of like, you know, you have a hit, you don't have a hit. It doesn't matter. You know, I have a loving wife and I have three amazing kids and we're getting by. And, you know, it was a really leveling. And I'm glad that it didn't make its life on being a 9/11 song, because it didn't.
No.
It went on to have its own life.
But it's a part of the story.
But it's a part of the story.
It is a part of the story.
I feel like the charts stopped doing. Nobody played music during that week. Everybody wanted information. No entertainment. No one was in a mood for entertainment. Where do we stand in Bloodlines? Who do we send money to? How can we help?
I was working at the Nashville Nightlife Theater, and a great singer, Kenny Dale. Thank you, Matt. Kenny Dale, who had some hits in the 70s, early 80s. I was doing a show out there at the theater with him, and he and I just stood on the back part of the theater, and we were just looking out. There was no planes. There were no planes in the air.
That's right.
None. It was just a clear sky. Nobody. We just said, "Wow, this is something." You know.
Yeah.
And we just turned. We still have a show to do. Let's go out there and do it.
Yeah. You know? And the thing was, which is a great. That's what I was speaking about, the spirit of America and being able to come together like that after such a tragedy. Getting back to the business of music, when they just didn't put a chart out because no one was playing. Right. But when the chart came back on. There were only three songs that had any upward mobility, and it was God Bless the USA, Faith Hill's national anthem, Star Spangled Banner, and Bring on the Rain.
Decent company? Pretty good company.
I mean, it was just, it's like, wow.
You know, it's a weird side note to that, because you know how Elton John, what a nut I am about Elton John's music, right? You know that.
Oh, yeah.
One of my biggest influences, easily. Here's a weird little side note. I remember being so proud of you, because Bring on the Rain was number 10 on the adult contemporary chart, which is awesome. That's another, you know, that's not country chart, it's the AC chart. Elton John's This Train Don't Stop, which is a great song, was number 11.
We were ahead of Elton.
That's what I remember going, Billy, this song's so good, it's ahead of Elton.
That's awesome.
He's got Elton beat on the charts. I mean, that's a little side thing, but I'm going, my buddy Billy Montana is ahead of Elton John right now on the chart. Can you do some Bring on the Rain?
I'll do it. Yeah.
Yes!
Another day is almost come and gone. I can't imagine what else could go wrong. Well, sometimes I'd like to hide away somewhere and lock the door. A single battle lost, but not the war. 'Cause tomorrow's another day, and I'm thirsty anyway. So bring on the rain. It's almost like the hard times circle round. A couple drops, and then they all start coming down. Yeah, and I might feel defeated, and I might hang my head. I might be barely breathing.
That is so awesome. Everybody, if you just tuned in, this is the Don Ellis Gatlin, that's me, show. my awesome bandmate Savannah Jack and our great, great special guest, Mr. Billy Montana, right here, everybody.
Thank you, thank you. Yeah. Y'all are awesome. Thank you.
Now, during that time, in the late 90s, early 2000, you and I were having some good luck on the getting stuff cut.
We did.
It was a great run for us there during that. We had the a song by a very talented group, Ricochet, did one of our songs.
Last called Love in This Town.
And do you remember what inspired that song, the song we were all listening to at that time? I still do.
Tell me.
What if God was one of us?
No way. Wow.
We were all listening to that song. I remember it coming out. We were over at Steve's.
I love that song.
Over Tom Collins.
Yep.
And I remember all of us were like, that song's so awesome. We go, well, let's do something. I think you said it. I go, let's do something like that.
Yeah.
Like the flavor of that. And then you and I had a great moment. We had a song recorded by Mr. Kenny Rogers.
Yes.
And for me, that's...
Again, Brent Mayer produced that record.
Brent Mayer.
Yeah, so...
And Dwayne Eddy on guitar.
That's right.
Rock and Roll Hall of Famer. But
that
the thing for me,
great experience.
I'm driving down the road, Billy, and that's the only time I've ever had a song that someone recorded of ours that I ever cried on. Because, like, you know what a Kenny Rogers fan. I also want to do a shout out to the Kenny Rogers band, who I've been doing shows with, along with Tony. That's the time it just got to me. Because, like, my whole childhood, like, I just wanted to meet him.
That's a dream come true, dude.
I want to meet him someday. You knew that. I just want to meet him.
You used to imitate him.
Yeah.
You sang him. You did him better than he did him. Is that possible?
Our manager at the time made me do my Kenny impersonation in front of him. And we were in the studio with Tony Brown.
Ooh,
and he goes,
man.
Hey, he does the best you ever heard. I'm like, I'm going to kill you.
I am.
Sing your song, sweet music, man. So... But so I did that. That was a really surreal moment for me.
It might have been a sad.
It might have been. But he sang it beautifully. And there's
great
a little
record story
again, folks out there in the business, a little inside story on that one. And you were the one that I think found out the information. For whatever reason, we were all both super excited about this cut by Kenny Rogers. And we found out that for some reason or another that Kenny's people at the time wanted more publishing on it, out of the blue. Do you remember the story? They wanted
last
publishing
minute
on the song. And we were like, at the last minute, we're like, you know, Billy and I are just trying to keep a roof over our heads. And they want more money from the song. So you found out because, Brent, you saw the artwork and you saw that they had lyrics printed for every song on the album, already on all
it's
the sleeves.
No, that's okay. We're good to go.
Yeah, so we called their bluff. So you know what? Go ahead and take it off the album. Take it off 500,000 copies. You know, so that saved our cut there. And we also had a song, was another great thrill for me. I think it was for you too. We wrote a song together for a movie.
Yeah.
We wrote a song for
animated movie.
What's that?
Animated movie.
Animated film called Tom Sawyer, MGM film. And we actually come up with we had a couple songs we wrote for it. One made it. Song's called Friends for Life.
Yep.
You don't remember any of that by weird chance, do you? Any of that? But it was in the film? Yeah. Maybe I don't remember it either. Dies. But we wrote this song, and in the film, the animated voices were Don Knotts, Betty White. So it's some great folks that were doing
the
voices.
And Leanne Womack.
Leanne Womack's in
that.
She sure is.
Red
Akins. And Mark Wills recorded our song,
mm-hmm.
which is pretty cool considering all the success Rhett's had.
It was awesome because we got a script in advance, I remember, and we saw where the songs would go, and we were like, hey, let's write something when they're on Jackson's Island, when Huck and Tom are on Jackson's Island. And, you know, so we wrote Friends for Life.
And they loved it.
Ended up making the movie.
And the great moments when we had a conference call, we're sitting around with the people at the desk there at MCA Records.
Yep.
And they put the... intercom there in the middle, and we're talking to whoever those people were in Hollywood.
Hollywood. We were talking to Hollywood, you know.
They fully scored our song with a whole orchestra. It was pretty cool. But then, again, amazing song. The 2000s happened, and we talk about Bring on the Rain. But that's the amazing thing. Billy, you finally got that number one, but you did not stop there. That was just the beginning of this
good.
Incredible run that runs to this day. What was the next big Billy Montana hit?
Suds in the Bucket.
Suds in the Bucket, Sara Evans, again. I'm watching that album do okay.
Yeah, because you were,
I was at the
you
airport.
You had an eye on that, yeah.
Yes. I was literally at the Ernest Tubb record store. Is a great, legendary record store that has been, there's still one in Nashville. And they have all the country product. But I noticed that the album that's on was not selling with the first two singles. I mean, they were hits, but they weren't turning product. It was like we talked about before the show started. There's songs that are radio hits, and then there's hits that sell.
That drive sales.
Right. Yeah. Suds in the Bucket came out, and it was gigantic, absolutely huge. How about, for fun, get the fellas to back you up, get the fiddle.
Come on, man.
Y'all ready? Little Savannah Jack, Billy Montana, number one song, Suds in the Bucket, he wrote. It goes like this.
Yes, she was in the backyard, say it was a little past nine. When her prince pulled up, white pickup truck. Folks should have seen it coming, only just a matter of time. Plenty old enough, and you can't stop love. She stuck a note on the screen door, sorry but I got to go. That was all she wrote, her mama's heart was broke. All she wrote, so the story goes. Now her daddy's in the kitchen staring at the window, scratching and a wreck in his brain. Like an 18 years or so, and on the plane. Our little ponytail girl grew up to be a woman. She's gone in a blink of an eye. She left the suits in the bucket and her clothes hanging out on the line. Woo! Wonder what the preacher gonna preach about Sunday morn. Nothing quite like this has happened here before. Yeah, he must have been a looker, smooth talking son of a gun, for such a grounded girl to just up and run. Of course you can't fence time, and you can't shop gossip going nonstop, sipping on pink lemonade. Like at 18 years, just up and walk away. Our little ponytail girl grew up to be a woman. She's gone in the blink of an eye. Come on, she left the suits in a bucket and her clothes hanging out on the line. We need a little picking now. Vegas tonight. I could 18 years just up and walk away. The little ponytail girl grew up to be a woman. She's gone in the blink of an eye. She left the suits in a bucket and her clothes hanging out on the line. Yeah, she left the suits in a bucket and her clothes hanging out on the line. That's right. Well, now she was in the backyard. Say it was a little past nine. When her prince pulled up, white pickup truck, plenty old enough, and you can't stop love. No, you can't fence time, and you can't stop.
Second number one song right there he wrote. Amazing. Amazing.
Wrote that with Janai.
Yes.
Bring on the Rain with Helen Darling. I don't know if we mentioned her, but
right.
She had been an artist on Decca Records.
Both girls, great singers, too.
Yeah, and Janai was on our song that Kenny Rogers sang. She's background vocalist.
She's very talented lady.
Yeah.
The also around that time, we got lucky enough to start working with we got the chance to work with artists at the beginning of their careers. That's happened for us too, And I think around that time, early 2000s, we got to write with a guy named Joe Nichols, who was just starting his career. And what a great country singer. Again, a real good. I knew Joe for 3 or 4 years before that. He was doing, he'd ask to sing, get up and sing karaoke when he, you know, they all start somewhere. And he just kept at it. He was a bartender. Just kept great pursuing singer. His dream. And great country singer. And we wrote some good ones with him. And then another guy we got to write with and got even more lucky with him as far as getting them recorded was a guy named Blake Shelton.
That's right.
Yes. Woo! Yes. And the first song, I'm very proud of, especially my buddy Jason Manning, because it's a true story.
We're
over there writing at your publishing company.
That's right.
And
Diana's place.
Blake had this idea for Red Georgia Clay was the song he wanted to write. And I had this idea, Problems at Home.
Right.
And you were kind of in the middle. You're like, you're kind of nudging me. Don, he's the artist. Let him pick what he wants.
Let's you do know? Let's do Blake.
Yeah, let's do what Blake wants to do, Don. Okay. But I'm like going, I really was headstrong on this one. And I said, I really think we should write this song. I think this is a big one. And so my buddy Jason Manning is working over at Buzz Kaysen's, a legend in the business.
Right across the parking lot.
Right across the parking lot. So I said, well, I'll tell you what we'll do. I'll bring my friend over, Jason Manning, and whatever Jason decides is a better idea, that's the one we'll write.
It's a lot of pressure on Jason, but
it was.
We he handled it well.
Jason's no longer with us. No, I'm kidding. No, he's with us. He's doing great. He's in Texas doing great. But so he comes over, and of course, immediately he says, "Oh, I mean, problems at home.
Problems at home.
Problems
like,
home is
like,
definitely."
He was like, "Without a doubt.
Without a doubt." So we wrote it, and it was on. Blake recorded it. Did a great job on it. And it's a song that we almost got it bumped from the record because of 9/11. There's a line in it in the song about New York. So we went from being a favorite as a single to maybe not even making the album. That shows you how something like 9/11 can affect individual people too, more than just, you know, because it almost affected us. And we actually spent 9/11 with Blake. When 9/11 happened, we were with riding with Blake.
Yeah, he called. I remember. You remember you used to have those telephones where they had wires, like the curly wires, and they went to this thing. And they actually, it was a box that hung on the wall, and like when it rang, like there was a bell, and then you would take it off, and you could But here's the thing, people: you could only go as far as the wire would let you go. So,
I don't go back that far.
My kitchen phone rang, and it was Blake. It was after 9/11. It was 9/11. It was that day. And he says, "Man, he says I don't feel like writing today, but I don't feel like being alone either."
Give me a song too.
I was like, "Man, let's just meet like we were planning to." And so we met down at the publishing company, and Diana took us out for Mexican food. Not a plane in the sky. It's weird.
It was a weird day, but it's something that it's like it's weird when you think back, all the craziness, all and how just terrible that was, and you go, the weird thing about it, we spent it with Blake Shelton.
That was weird too.
It was very strange.
He was a great hang. He's the same guy.
Still is.
Yeah. Same guy now that he was then. So he's.
But he didn't wear a cowboy hat anymore. He was really hard strung. He was really like, I'm never cutting my mullet. Remember that? He was like, I'm never cutting this mullet. I'm wearing the cowboy hat, and somebody talked to him. Somebody got to him. It was a good call. And I remember.
I have a great picture of you and me and him in the kitchen.
That's a great pic. I've seen it. That's a great pic.
Yeah, we look like badasses.
And this is, I shouldn't tell this, but hey, that's what we're going to do every show. I shouldn't tell this, but we're going to do it. I remember Blake made me, I've told a couple people this story, but it's true. I shouldn't, I'm going to say it anyway. Blake made me a top 10 list of girls he wants to hook up with. And this was in 2002. He made me a list of babes he wants to hook up.
Okay.
You know who he was in love with who was number one on his list at the time?
No.
The girl from the Wilkinsons, the lead singer of the Wilkinsons.
Yeah.
Do you remember them?
Amanda.
The father? Yeah, Amanda.
Yeah.
And the father's daughter, son.
Sure.
And but on that list, folks, Gwen Stefani.
Are you serious?
That's a true story. Was on that list. 2002, no doubt, was huge in 2002. And he had her. She's on the list. I'll show you the list after the show.
Man,
I have it in my pocket. No,
so he probably feels about the same as you did when we got our Kenny Rogers cut.
Exactly. Maybe not. I don't know how that's connected, but
Just a dream come true.
That's he felt the same way when we met our wives.
Yeah, a dream come true.
Yes, yes.
Brownie points.
Wow.
So there's a song that we wrote during that period also that got recorded by everybody, I'm very proud to say. And it got recorded in 2012 by a great, great singer, another hero vocalist, Lee Greenwood. The song is called Dancing With No Music Plan.
That's my favorite record of.
He killed it.
He crushed it.
Now, Colin Ray recorded our song first, great singer. And then a group I was doing some touring with, Yankee Gray,
yep,
did it. Pam Tillis wanted to record the song, and she's the one that talked us into the bridge, though. We didn't have a bridge originally, if you remember, on this song.
I remember that.
And she said, I'm going to do this song, but I want a bridge. And I looked at you and said, there was nothing to say. And went, that's it.
That's the bridge.
That's it. That's our bridge.
So can now we, the bridge is, there's nothing to say.
Can we have the Billy Montana, Savannah Jack version of Dancing With No Music Playing?
Let's do it.
We'll do it for you live here on the Don Ellis Gatlin Show. Billy Montana, everybody.
Me and my rented tuxedo, you and your big sister's dress, I could feel my own heart beating when you laid your head on my chest. No telling how long it was since the last song, with the band gone and the lights all fading. Dancing with no music playing.
Me and my rented tuxedo, you and your mama's white dress, rice in your hair, your shoes and one hand caressing. Holding each other, dancing with no music playing. Ooh, there's nothing to say.
My
Savannah
bandmates.
Jack.
over there on lead guitar. He's amazing. Songwriter, guitarist, Mr. Tony Hahn. Oh,
thank you, sir. Thank you.
Awesome, Tony.
Back there on the drums, Mr. Phil Potter.
Yeah, woo!
Here at, for the first time in this studio, he's amazing. Just had a beautiful baby. He didn't, his woman did, but he did a good job.
Good to hear.
Supervising. Mr. David Abdel on the bass. Hey,
David.
And this amazing talented fiddle player to my left is Mr. Jay Smith.
Yeah.
Awesome. We have an amazing guys. We have Matt, Jarrett, John, all these guys behind the scenes, and they're very talented musicians, songwriters themselves.
Thank you.
Glad to know them. And I'll tell you what, Billy, you are actually our first guest.
I love that. I mean,
again, as a future, people watch us down the line, they'll say, oh, he was the first guest.
I love that.
Show number one. Hopefully, there'll be 1,000 shows.
Show 0001.
Yes. Yes. And I tell you, I really want this to be what you are making it exactly what I wanted to do is let people see the amazing talented people we have in this town. And there's no more talent than this guy right here. Again, brother. Billy Montana, everybody.
And you, Don Ellis Gatlin. Oh.
Thank you, sir. Well, that was the second number one. And that's the thing that's so amazing is that you were here in the 80s writing great stuff. The 90s happened. 2000 happened. And the weird thing is you're only 32. Okay.
I know, because we moved here when I was
eight. It's really strange.
Which is cool.
Yeah. But the 2000s happened, and there's more hits keep coming. What was the next number one after that?
It was in 2007.
Oh, my gosh.
And it was a song that my new best friend Garth Brooks had a hit with.
Folks, Garth Brooks. This song was the fastest number one song in the history of music.
Yeah.
That's all.
Yeah, it took a week to get to number one. 1 week.
And your buddy, you wrote it with your buddy Lee Bryce,
yes.
Right?
Yep.
And Lee is so talented.
Amazing.
One and of the best true talents of the
town. You know what, too? You can get the demo on iTunes. You can get Lee's version of this song, and it's amazing. It'll kick your butt. And Kyle Jacobs is a third writer
and if, on this, too. And if Lee doesn't give me a nice chunk of money,
yeah,
I'm going to play the version I have of him intoxicated on stage with us at the stage down on Broadway.
You could probably
it's up to you.
You can get a little something, probably.
It will be
something.
A bonus extra. Matt, were you with us that night? Oh, my gosh. Lee is so talented, one of the true talents in this town. He got up on stage with us. He did it a couple times. But this particular time, he had been a-drinking.
He'd been a-drinking.
And
he'd gotten into the wine.
He was so funny. It was hysterical. But he was doing it. He wanted to do Lady Down Her Love by Alabama. And he was like, now she's a lady down. On love. Listen to you. You
I'm learning. I got the tape to learn their show.
It's on there, isn't it? Am I lying?
I heard it.
Oh, my God.
Come on, guys.
Come on, people. Alabama's the greatest group ever. They're the reason I came to town. It's getting all emotional. It's the funniest thing you've ever heard in your life. And it's like, I've got Lee on tape just sober and singing his butt off. But that's funnier.
Amazing. That
it's
is
a great
awesome.
If Lee doesn't want it to come out on YouTube as a bonus feature for our new show.
That's hilarious.
Call me, Lee. We can make us. We're gonna get some back, you know, extra things. And maybe a dishwasher. It's up to you. The thing is, but this song is one of those songs. Everyone knows the song. It's on the greatest hits package. He recorded like three new songs. This was one of them, and. The fastest number one song in the history of music, everybody. And it's just a great, great song. We'll live on forever.
Yeah.
Little song called More Than a Memory. I said that wrong.
No, you said it
right. I said it right.
More than a memory,
everybody. More than a memory. Yeah. Everybody.
You want some? You want some of this?
I want some of that. Give him some, Billy.
People say she's only in my head.
Woo!
It's going to take time, but I'll forget. They say I need to get on with my life. What they don't realize is when you're dialing six numbers just to hang up the phone, driving across town to see if she's home.
Waking a friend in the dead of the night, just to hear him say it'll be alright. When you're finding things to do to not fall asleep, 'cause you know she'll be there in your dreams. That's when she's more than a memory. I took a match to everything she ever wrote, watched her words go up in smoke, tore all the pictures off the walls. That ain't helping me at all, 'cause when you're talking out loud and nobody's there, when you look like hell and you just don't care, when you're drinking more than you ever drank, sinking down lower than you ever sank, when you find yourself falling down on your knees, praying to God, begging him please, that's when she's more than a memory. Yeah. She's more than a memory.
That is a monster. That is a huge, great, great, great song.
So one of the coolest things ever that happened, I have a couple of stories that happened. You remember Jerry Vandiver?
Yes, gosh.
Yeah, so I was writing with Jerry.
What a song with him.
Back in 1993, probably. Yeah. 94, maybe. And 93 it was. And my publisher, while we were writing, he said, hey, come up to my office, you know, when you get a break. So I went up and my publisher said, hey, I just want you to know we're not going to renew your publishing deal. This was 93, and Garth was huge. Yes. You know, he had his, it was just the most amazing career to see, yeah, starting in 1989 and just what had happened in those four short years. Oh, yeah. So I go downstairs, and Jerry's like, what was that all about? And I said, well, they're not going to renew my publishing deal. I hope I get a big old Garth Brooks hit or something. And by golly, 14 years later, I did. Blink of an eye, people. Blink of an eye.
But you're hanging out with Garth at the listening party, right? You're hanging out with Garth. You guys are still contacting each other every now and then, aren't you?
Uh-huh. He just, I was going to tell you that.
Yeah.
Story.
So, but at this, Garth's at the listening party, and I'm telling you, you know how Garth is. He's just the most incredible person,
he's
authentic.
Amazing.
He never, I mean,
he's amazing.
If he's a fraud, he's a fraud 24/7 because he's the awesome. Real deal. He's
so
awesome
genuine.
Person. So, he's that, and I love this. I remember this when he said this to you. He goes, I've been wanting to cut a Billy Montana song for a long time.
I met
Isn't him.
That
awesome.
I met him in '89, yeah. And
I did too.
His Bob Doyle, his manager, had said, "Hey, I'm working with this guy," and he says, "Stop by my office," and he says, "I think you guys would do great writing together." And so Bob gave me a Maxell cassette tape with no label on there or anything. Yeah. It was just like a.
That reminds me of my true story, Maxell tape.
And he put it, and so I was like, man, there's some really good songs on here. Like, I think The Dance was on there, and If Tomorrow Never Comes, and stuff like that. And so I ran into Garth writing at Bob's company, my new best friend, Garth Brooks, and I ran into him in a, and I was like, hey, you know, Bob talked about you and me writing together sometime. He says, yeah, that would be great. We're really trying to get this first single off the ground, but once things slow down a little bit,
yeah,
I'd love to get together and write.
Never
it's
happened.
Just like, yeah, he never looked back. He never
happened.
Never happened.
You did remind me of the story of the movie. You said Maxell tape, because you know this story. It's a unfortunately, it's a true story.
I think I know this story.
It's a true story. I've told you before, and this is again people out there in the business trying to hang in there because.
Are you going to tell a story you shouldn't tell?
No, I'm gonna, this ain't a bad story, but it's a true story. So I'm our second album came out. It's been out for a while. My brother and I's second album on Sony. So I go, it's about 2 years after the fact, I go into the Ernest Tubb record shop again. And they have the Ernest Tubb, it's a tub of a discount tapes.
Discount bin.
Yeah, it's called,
bin,
yeah, exactly that.
Is. Yes, Matt.
So I look in there and I just start scooping around.
He's got a thesaurus over there.
Right. So I'm looking around the tapes. I'm like, oh no, there was my brother and I's tape in there. For $1. It was there. My brother and I, we were in the tub. I swear to God, true story. I glance up. There were Maxell blank tapes for $4. Nothing, absolutely nothing was worth $3 more than the best my brother and I had to offer.
Hey,
air.
I don't
wanna. Air was $3 more.
You know, the band, studio time, photography, all the packaging, all of that is
Blake
worth
Maxwell
less.
Yeah, $3
than
less.
Maxwell cassette.
$3 less.
Like a lot less.
They were brand new.
They were brand new. And packaged really nice.
I can top your dollar, though, because I was like, years ago, I was like, man, I wonder if any of those No Yesterday records of mine, the CDs are still out there, you know. So I just Googled No Yesterday, Billy Montana, and I found two used CDs for sale for a penny each.
Oh, my.
So I bought them.
You bought Christmas gift.
$2.98 shipping. Well, I wanted to be able to tell
the shipping was way more.
Yeah, $2.98.
That's right.
But I wanted to be able to tell the story that I got to buy my own album for a penny.
I literally can hear half of Music Row packing up and leaving, going home from our encouraging stories.
Getting back to Garth,
yes.
One of the coolest things about that song, about More Than a Memory, was that Lee, and I didn't know this, you know, they give plaques, they give awards to hang on the walls for, like, there's an award, Phil Vassar Award, hanging over there, and, you know, there's, like, that's kind of a kudo to the writers or the publishers or whatever.
Absolutely.
So Lee, about 3 years ago, called me, and he said, hey, man, are you going to be in town? He called me on a Thursday. He said, you going to be in town on Monday? I'm doing a radio interview, and they want me to bring a songwriter friend to talk about songwriting. So I thought I'd bring you. I'm like, heck yeah, dude, you kidding? I'm honored you would ask. So he starts texting me directions and all that on Monday, and it was down to Bridgestone Arena. You know, it's where satellite radio in the tower, Bridgestone Arena. So I go in, and I'm waiting for him. They tell me where to park, and it was CMA Fest. So it was Monday of CMA, not CMA Fest. Yes, it was. No, it wasn't. CMA Awards. That's what it was, because it was in November. So it was the Monday, and the awards were going to be Wednesday. So all of several streets are blocked off downtown, right? So, but wherever I go, they got their list, and I'm on my name's on their list, and I'm like, it's the coolest thing ever.
Yeah.
Like, they're letting me in on these blocked roads and parking right in the arena, and security was waiting for me and said, we're going to put you in a golf cart and we'll take you down to the studio.
The Bruce Willis thing had nothing to do with it.
No. I didn't. I'm very friendly whenever I can be, and only mean when I have to be. So so they take me down to the studio, and I walk in the studio, and Lee has this kind of gleam in his eye, and there's no radio people there, and Garth is there. Garth Brooks is there. Mm. And I'm thinking, why did Lee not tell me I was going to be hanging out with Garth Brooks on Monday night? And it was Garth Brooks Facebook Live.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. And so just like we have stools set up like here, you know, Garth, everything goes the way he says it. He goes, okay, Billy, we're going to, you know, and I'm like, cool, Garth, whatever you say, man. He says, I'm going to introduce, we're going to talk for a little bit. I'm going to bring Lee out, talk for about maybe 10, 15 minutes, get into More Than a Memory, bring you up, sit in this stool, and then you talk about, like, you know, how the song comes together. And I'm like, okay, Garth. It's awesome. I love that.
Yeah.
I had just enough time to text my family and say, I don't know what's happening, but if you can get on Garth Brooks Facebook Live, do it now.
The biggest stars, I mean, I've Facebook Live's had Billy Joel, you know, Steve Warner, friend.
It's crazy.
You're in that gang.
So then I cut my phone off because I wanted to pay attention to what was happening.
Anyway, exactly.
Anyway, so it went just like Garth said, as I knew it would. And then so he gets me up there, and so in the midst of questioning, he says, Billy, does Lee have an award for More Than a Memory? Because he said the album that's on, The Ultimate Hits, has sold 10 million. And I was like, he does, Garth. I've seen his award. It's hanging on his wall.
But you didn't have one.
I didn't have one. He says, did he invite you when they presented him a 10 million award? I said, no. Did they invite you? He said, no. Don't you think they should have? And I said, yes. He said, well, we're not going to make that mistake.
Oh, my gosh.
And he reached down and handed me a plaque for $10 million.
Awesome.
Yeah. Coolest thing that's ever happened to me in the music business.
That is awesome, man. I was just at your house recently, and your little office there is getting pretty impressive. The wall is completely covered with number one and gold records and VMI awards.
He asked
me. Weird thing is with ASCAP. I'm kidding.
That's really weird.
That's really weird.
But he asked me, he says, you have a wall you can put this on? I said, Garth, I'm going to build a wall to put this on.
Exactly.
Are you kidding me?
Exactly. That's incredible. Well, going back, you mentioned Lee again. One of your hits, again, I think this went all the way at the top of the charts.
It did.
Yes. Gosh, it's a great song. Thanks. And here's a weird thing. When I heard this song, okay, I didn't know when it first happened. I didn't know which songs. You had three or four songs on that album.
Three on that record, I think. Yeah.
Right? And I didn't even have to know. I just stylistically, I knew it was you.
No way.
Yes, I did. I go, I would awesome, bet the man. Farm on it that Billy is a writer of this song.
I love that.
Because it had that Billy Montana magic in there, that storytelling, just that all you could hear was Billy Montana music on that song.
Yeah, Ben Glover, John Osier, and I wrote this. We were on a writing retreat, which is a...
Could you do a little bit of this one?
I'll do a little bit. Do verse chorus.
Sure. See if y'all recognize this one. Number one song for Lee Bryce. Billy wrote. With Lee.
I am insensitive. I have a tendency to pay more attention to the things that I need. Sometimes I drink too much. Sometimes I test your trust. Sometimes I don't know why you stay with me. I'm hard to love, hard to love. I don't make it easy. I couldn't do it if I stood where you stood. Hard to love, hard to love. You say that you need.
Bryce, number one.
Hard to love.
The thing about Billy is so great, again, is that decade after decade, like some writers have their, I mean, some actually Hall of Fame songwriters have had that. I mean, I think about even Kris Kristofferson. You think about the songs that he wrote in that little window from like 69 to 72. It's insane.
He had three Song of the Years.
Yeah.
In that span.
It's like, it's insane. But, and again, he wrote good songs after that. I'm not saying they didn't. But that
was his time.
That was his time. What's so wonderful about you, Billy, is that when is your time? You've had every decade your time. Right now, and I can't say this for all the writers I've known that are still writing today. You're writing, in my opinion, and I think the industry's opinion, some of the best songs you've ever written. Folks, he's got songs on the charts right now. This is, what is it? Today is June 19th. 2024, you know, when it's on, you know, people watch this 5 years from now. Folks, at this moment right now, Billy's got a couple songs on the charts, and they're awesome songs. That song, Mattress on the Floor? This song, who's the artist on that song?
Mo Pitney,
folks. And he does a wonderful job.
He does.
Again, I've been lucky enough to write with you, sing demos for you. All those things. This is so Billy Montana song. I mean, you might have a co-writer on this one.
It was my son Randy.
Who's awesome.
And Matt.
Yes.
Alden. Yeah. Yeah.
Randy's wonderful.
What a blessing to be able to write one like this with him. But it was my title.
It's.
And I was like, and they were
it
like.
Has that essence.
Him and Matt. It was Matt Alderman's the third writer, and they were like, love. Like they knew right away we could do something with it.
My father, who's no longer with us, his favorite song in the whole world was The House of a Thousand Dreams.
Oh, wow.
And and this, I told you at the house the other day, to me, I think this song was like a cousin of that.
You're right.
It has this incredible image.
No, you're right.
And this song has, to me, it reminds me of like a cousin of that song. Can you play a little bit of that one?
Oh, absolutely.
This song is moving up the charts. Folks, 5 years from now, it won't mean as much. But right now, in this moment, June 19th, this song is probably going to go all the way number one again for Billy. Check this out. Yes.
Mattress on the floor, boxes in the hall, no pictures in the frames,
No frames on the wall. Light bulb on a wire. Loose change in a drawer. Bed sheet on the window. Mattress on the floor. Woo. Car keys on the counter. Take out in the fridge. Beatles on her t-shirt. Box wine on her kiss. Promise on her finger. Says whatever's mine is yours. Hey, you gotta start out somewhere. Mattress on the floor.
Woo! That song is huge. Oh my gosh, that song's great.
Thank you,
Billy. Well, I want to do, this was not in the show at plan, but I want to do another jam with my fellas.
Let's do Savannah
it. Savannah Jack. This is another song we wrote with Blake Shelton. It's on the Dreamer album. And it's a little song about growing up in the country.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up in Brady's Run Holler, so I got that in there. We grew up in the holler. Little song called My Neck of the Woods. You guys want to try that? Yeah. Wouldn't plan. Little Savannah Jack, Billy Montana, Blake Shelton, music. Yes. The live version. Yes, he's on. Yes. Little song called My Neck of the Woods. Goes like this. Woo! Grandpa's down by the two lane in the blazing sun of the pouring rain. Sounds to me as from the back of his pickup truck. Reads the Bible line for line, sipping on some homemade wine. That's who he is and what he does. He's just like us. And the coffee on. My whole life has been that way. All right. We come from back in the hollers. Got sweat on our blue collars. The living's hard, but the living's good. It's like God sent the heavens down. Hung around my neck of the woods. Before, if you just joined in, it's Don Ellis Gatlin Show. That's me, unbelievable bandmates Savannah Jack, feature them, and our first guest. Boy, I hope you come back and do this again someday.
If you ask, I'll be back.
Billy Montana, everybody, come on!
Thank you so much.
Now, every show we do, we're gonna have the influence. What helped this artist want to be an artist and want to be a writer. And Billy's, I knew his pick.
You did.
It's actually, this song covers both of them. Because you're a big, big Jackson Brown guy. And I know you're a big, big Eagles guy. Mm-hmm. And so am I. And this song was written by the Eagles and Mr. Jackson Brown.
That's right. Glenn Frey and Jackson Brown wrote this.
That's right. A little song called Take It Easy. And we're going to take it out on this one, y'all. Thank you for everybody watching. Billy Montana, keep tuning in. We got a lot of great shows coming your way. Everybody, thank you. Take it, Billy.
Jack, Don Ellis Gatlin.
Thank you for watching out there on TV, YouTube, Facebook, all that great thing land. We'll see you down the line, everybody. Thank you so much. Keep checking out all the things. We have a lot of great shows coming your way. Couldn't ask for a better one with Billy Montana to start things off. Thank you, Billy.